A bimetal heat break consisting of copper threads and surgical stainless steel tubing is a pretty interesting concept that can potentially add quite some performance to your 3D printer. Let me show you how I was able to more than double the extrusion capability of my Ender 3, what happened when I cheaped out and bought a cheap knockoff part, and how I was pleasantly surprised when I spent the money and got the genuine one from SliceEngineering. Let's find out more. Guten Tag everybody, I'm Stefan and welcome to CNC Kitchen. This video was supported by Squarespace. Easily create your own professional website and support the channel at the same time by starting a free trial today at squarespace.com/cnckitchen. The BiMetal heat break is the next evolution of a regular heat break that we know from our 3D printers. Let me first tell you what makes this multi-material assembly unique. Let's benchmark the ones I bought for my Ender 3 with extrusion tests and test prints, and finally compare the standard Bowden solution to the $10 knockoff and the $30 genuine part. Let me know down in the comments if you ever used one of these heat breaks and if you'd rather do this upgrade instead of changing the whole hot end. So the heat break fits in between the hot end and the cold end and is used to have a very sharp temperature gradient between the molten material and the filament that's fed to the nozzle. This part is important because if you don't have this sharp gradient, the filament tends to get soft way before the heating zone and eventually blocks the filament path. This is what we call heat creep. In order to accomplish that, all metal hot ends usually have a heat break with a very thin walled throat where only a minimum amount of heat can travel through. Stainless steel is often used in this application, or even more recent heat breaks use titanium, which features an even smaller heat transfer coefficient but comes with other downsides. Bowden hot ends do have a slightly different approach and use the even worse thermal conductivity of the PTFE to isolate the hot end from the cold end, though this just on the side. The bimetal heat break improves on the all metal heat break in a way that it is a multi-part and multi-material construction. It features a thin metal tube that guides the filament. This has a couple of advantages. Stainless steel tubes are available with very thin walls, thinner than you would be comfortable when machining them. The thinner the wall, the less heat can be conducted and the sharper the temperature transition. Also, due to their manufacturing process, they can be stronger than regular stainless steel, and the surface finish is also very smooth, which reduces friction. Then there's the upper part of the heat break, which is made from copper, so all the heat that made it through the thin tube is transmitted very quickly into the heatsink, where it dissipates and therefore also helps avoiding heat creep. Let's finally get to the lower threads that are also made from copper for a particular reason. These sit in the heater block and they help to increase the length of your melting zone and will start heating your filament efficiently all the way from the start. Yes, with the standard stainless steel, you'll also have some material melted in the section, but since it doesn't conduct heat that well, it won't be able to melt the filament that efficiently, especially at faster print speeds. The three parts are then probably heat shrunk together, which requires all of the parts to be of high precision and the right alloy. If they aren't, there is the risk that the press fit decreases at higher temperatures, which I heard happening with some non-genuine parts. Speaking of non-genuine, I know bimetal heat breaks from SliceEngineering hot ends, especially their latest Copperhead. When I first heard about their claims about higher melting rates in a size that's equal to a V6, I was intrigued and I wanted to try it out. SliceEngineering only doesn't offer the heat break for their Copperhead hot end, but they also sell them for other machines, like the hugely popular Ender series. One machine I had serious problems in that regard was my Ender 3 Pro I used in the last year for printing face shields. The thing was that my Prusa was more than double as fast in printing those parts. In terms of numbers, I had to limit the melting rate of the Ender 3 to 5 cubic millimeters a second, whereas the Prusa was able to easily print at 12 cubic millimeters a second before the filament started skipping or grinding. That is, of course, partly due to the double-sided Bontech gears and the short and straight filament path. So even though the material might not be properly melted, the Prusa was able to just force the filament through the nozzle. Since the feed system of the Ender is weak As soon as the filament didn't melt anymore properly, the back pressure increased and the filament started skipping. To get an idea what those numbers mean, I sliced a 3D Banshee 4 and Ender 3 at a layer height of 0.16 mm. What you can see is that depending on the feature, our volumetric flow rate is around 2 to 4.5 cubic millimeters a second. What I want to say with that is that if you're only printing slow at fine layer heights and with the standard 0.4 mm nozzle, you're usually not that concerned with melting rates. So as soon as you want to go faster, thicker or wider, this becomes important. To benchmark the change in extrusion capability, I ran an extrusion test in which I always extruded the same amount of filament, just at a different extrusion speed, and weighed the resulting material spiral. If the filament skips or strips, the real amount of extruded filament will be smaller, which means we under-extruded. I tested the whole range of extrusion rates, from a slow 1 cubic millimeters a second up to 20 cubic millimeters a second using a simple G-code. The standard Bowden setup results show that the faster we extrude, the less material is really pushed through the nozzle. At 5 cubic millimeters a second, we are only extruding 93%, and starting at 10 cubic millimeters a second, we really dip downwards and can see a lot of grinding at the feeder gear. I performed this test with a freshly reseated Bowden tube and no gap between it and the nozzle. But like you may know, if you don't do anything against it, the Bowden tube will slowly walk upwards over time, leaving you with a gap that's very bad for our printing performance. To simulate that, I intentionally moved the tube upwards by a millimeter and ran the extrusion test again, which shows that the extrusion performance is even worse and the dip in the curve due to grinding happens earlier at only 7 cubic millimeters a second. Just on a quick side note, if you have ever wondered why your models have bulges in certain regions, compare them with the flow rate in your slicer. These are often the locations where the printer prints significantly slower or faster than elsewhere. Therefore, you are more or less under extruding, and the section is becoming thicker or thinner. One reason to keep flow as constant as possible, or to make sure that you're only printing in a region where your extruder graph is very shallow. Oh, and if you like these videos and investigations, make sure to subscribe and select the bell to not miss any upcoming ones in the future. So I want to find out if I can increase the melting rate and therefore decrease the back pressure in the ender with one of these BiMetal heat breaks. Since I was cheap and I had a hard time finding a part in Germany, I purchased a knockoff BiMetal heat break for around 15 bucks from a German eBay seller. Assembly was pretty straightforward. I removed the fan shroud, heated the nozzle, removed the installed filament and unscrewed the nozzle. Then I removed the Bowden tube, removed the two screws that additionally secure the heater block to the heatsink, and loosened the small grub screw in the front of the heatsink to slide the heat break out. Since the lower threads were quite gunked up, I had to use brute force to unscrew it from the heater block. I then used an M6 tab to recut the threads and to remove the carbonized plastic. Installing the new BiMetal heat break was pretty straightforward. I screwed the nozzle into the heater block, making sure that there was still a gap for tightening, and screwed in the heat break from the other side. While installing it with plenty of thermal paste, I already noticed the first strange thing, because it was too short to bottom out in the heatsink. So I just pushed it in that it was flush with the heatsink and fixed it in place with the grub screw. Installing the Bowden tube was then also quite a pain. Since the distance between the hot end and the heatsink got smaller, I wasn't able to add the retaining screws and therefore had to really pay attention while hot tightening the nozzle. I then re-ran the extrusion test and oh boy, especially at the higher extrusion rates, this part helped to push so much more material out of the nozzle than the standard setup. Only at around 15 cubic millimeters a second, the feeder started really badly grinding. That looked promising with just a $15 part. Well, yes and no. Of course, I had to test its performance in a real printing test with retractions and everything, and this is where the problem started. On my 3D Banshee, I got serious extrusion problems, and tuning retractions only helped slightly. So there was obviously something wrong. This was the point where I contacted Dan from Slice Engineering and openly told him that I bought a knockoff heat break and if they see the same problems with their genuine parts. He assured me that they engineered their parts especially for less heat creep, lower retractions and more flow. So I went and figured out why my quick search didn't find genuine bimetal heat breaks. It's Copperhead heat break, and then I found the one for my Ender 3 as an option. Yay, local shipping from Germany. Once it arrived, it was interesting to see that the knockoff wasn't a straight copy, even though the design files and drawings for the Copperhead are open source. The copper sections are longer and Slice Engineering uses a grayish tungsten desulfide coating on their parts, probably for less friction on the inside and as an anti-seize on the threads. Installation was pretty similar to the knockoff. The only thing I noticed was that here the copper part on the cold side seemed to be a bit too long and protruded out of the heatsink, probably also not optimal. Anyways, I first performed the extrusion benchmark, which was interestingly slightly worse than the knockoff, but still a lot better than the standard setup. The really exciting part was the print tests. I first figured out the retraction length using 3D Optimizer's retraction test and only needed around 2 mm of retraction on a Bowden system, which was quite impressive. The prints I was now able to produce also didn't show any signs of heat creep or jamming anymore and came out beautifully, just as promised. Using the simple new heat break seems to add quite a bit to the Ender. For once, it now allows me to print way quicker. Then it seemed to help print quality by reducing retractions to only 2 mm and fixing the annoying problem with the Bowden tube wandering off. And then there's the temperature capability. The all metal heat break now allows me to push temperatures far above I was comfortable doing with the Bowden setup in order to print ABS, nylons or polycarbonate. I'm not 100% sure why the knockoff didn't work that well, but it's probably a combination of dimensions, parts and the coating. As a small summary, an all metal heat break can be better than a PTFE lined hot end because it requires less maintenance and improves the temperature capability. But if not done well, can even make your printing results worse due to more friction in the feeding section and potentially more heat creep if not done right. The Copperhead bimetallic heat break improves on the all metal concept with a higher melting rate due to the copper ends, perfect surface finish, and an even sharper temperature transition due to the thin surgical tubing including the coating they use. But it is also more fragile and costs a significant amount of money. I'm being totally honest here. If you have a printer and you're only processing PLA at slow speeds, you won't benefit a lot from this upgrade and might even break things or generate problems on a printer that works. I can guarantee that 1 of 10 that are trying to change the heat break will destroy either their heater wires or thermistor wires. But if you are into big nozzles, faster printing or more challenging materials, the genuine bimetallic Copperhead heat break seems to be a really capable and also simple upgrade, especially if you currently run a Bowden setup. But let me know what you think. If you, by the way, also want to test the extrusion capability of your 3D printer, then check out the website article to this video where I added the G-code file. This also brings me to today's video sponsor Squarespace that helps me creating this additional content for you in such an easy way. Squarespace is one of the easiest to use yet beautiful website development tools out there. People often ask me why I don't just use WordPress. I did that in the past, but I always struggled to create a design I liked. Then I permanently had to take care that my plugins were up to date, and when my blog got hacked, the hoster didn't have any recent backups, so everything was gone. That will not be the case with Squarespace all in one platform, where you just don't have to deal with plugins, patches or updates, ever. It's just working and so easy to set up without any web design knowledge. If you can use Word, then you can create your own website on Squarespace. Give it a try and start a free trial at squarespace.com/cnckitchen and use code cnckitchen to get 10% off your first purchase. If you still get stuck at any point, Squarespace offers great 24/7 support. Try it out totally for free and let them know who sent you by browsing squarespace.com/cnckitchen. Thank you, Squarespace, for sponsoring this video and make all of this possible. Thanks for watching, everyone. I hope you're all doing well. If you found this video helpful, then leave a like, share it with the community, and make sure that you subscribe for more. If you want to support my work, head over to Patreon, become a YouTube member, and take a look at my merch. Stay healthy, auf Wiedersehen, and I hope to see you in the next one.